night football game of the year is a big one, and that means this show is a big one. Welcome to NFL Total Access, presented by Bridgestone, everyone. Scott Hansen, Lindsay Rhodes, wishing you and yours happy holidays.
Two playoff berths clinched this weekend. That means that 10 of the 12 playoff spots are now accounted for, and we're down to five teams fighting for the other two spots, so that is the umbrella under which we will move forward with an eye toward the playoffs. And some information about injuries that could have an effect on things. Starting with Mark Ingram, who left yesterday's Ravens win with a calf strain that was confirmed today via MRI, will not play this week. Good thing the Ravens don't really need him to. They already have the one seed locked up, which gives them a bye for the first round of the playoffs. So he will have some time to rest. We'll see if he's better by the divisional round. Eagles do not have the luxury of a game to spare, so that makes the fact that Zach Ertz has a broken rib very concerning for them. Also impressive for him because he played in spite of that for three quarters yesterday. According to Doug Peterson, he's in a lot of pain. He says they're still trying to figure out the extent of the injury. Seahawks, meanwhile, are trying to figure out who's going to run the ball for them this week because Chris Carson fractured his hip yesterday and CJ Procise broke his arm. So neither of them will be available for this week's game. And Rashad Penny is already on injured reserve. So that leaves Travis Homer as their only healthy running back. And with only eight NFL rushing attempts to his name, five of which came yesterday, that's probably not a great option, Ian Rappaport. So what are they going to do?
They are going to call in an old friend. Seattle's expected to meet with Marshawn Lynch today. Beast mode headed back to Seattle, going to be in the building, meeting with Pete Carroll, the coach, taking a physical, meeting with general manager John Schneider, and moving closer and closer toward getting back in his old uniform. Yes, this is all happening. Barring a snag, Marshawn Lynch is expected to rejoin the Seahawks once again. So think about it. He retired. The Seahawks then traded him to his hometown, Oakland Raiders. Played a couple seasons for them, was last seen last year. His contract ran out. He's a free agent. He never sent in his retirement papers yet. He kind of quietly visited Seattle a couple weeks back just to renew some acquaintances. He told them he is in shape, and they certainly seem poised to move and sign Marshawn Lynch to fill a big hole in their backfield.
Marshawn Lynch, 8 days removed from serving tequila shots in a parking lot tailgate at the Raiders' last home game. Now getting ready to make a playoff run. It is the most Marshawn Lynch thing ever, and I love every bit of it. Scott?
Lindsay, let's go to the drama for Dallas yesterday in Philadelphia. Cowboys with a chance to clinch the NFC East, just beat the division rival Eagles. But Philadelphia has been in some late, dramatic December games in recent years. And Miles Sanders, the rookie running back, stood tall. 156 scrimmage yards and that touchdown right there. It all came down to a fourth down play for the Dallas Cowboys. Fourth quarter, they're trailing by eight. Need the touchdown and the two-point conversion. Fourth down and Michael Gallup can't come down with it. They took another look at this to make sure that Sidney Jones did not have pass interference. They said he didn't. So the Eagles win it 17-9. Eagles take over first place in the NFC East, looking like it could be another late December run by the Birds.
This is the team that when their back's against the wall, I mean, they come out swinging and fighting and whatever it takes. Sometimes it's not pretty and it doesn't have to be, you know, and put some plays together, score more points than our opponent, hold our opponents down, and, you know, just play great team football. And if we don't beat ourselves, we give ourselves a chance. And that was what happened tonight.
When you get in this spot, you give yourself a chance to be real disappointed. We are. The fact that we didn't get any scores, the fact the game turned out the way it did, we played well. I don't want to say about anything else other than it's very disappointing. We all expected to leave here as the NFC's champs. We're not. We had in mind stepping back up here and getting on a run and having some good things happen. This is a disappointing setback for that locker room and for all of us, and I know it is for the fans.
So as we speak, this is the NFC playoff picture. We already know division championships still on the line. The NFC West has yet to be decided. The NFC East is either going to be the Eagles or the Cowboys. And that's the last NFC playoff spot as well. A Philadelphia win on Sunday and they're in. A Philadelphia loss and a Dallas win would put the Cowboys in. Let's turn now to a Super Bowl champion who 2 or 3 weeks ago told told us the Philadelphia Eagles would be standing tall at the end of the division race.
Their
Cowboys fans didn't like that?
No, they didn't like that on Twitter.
David Carr with us right now. How did they get it done yesterday? Was this Philadelphia or was this Dallas?
Well, there was obviously it was Philadelphia. Doug Peterson had a great plan. I think the interesting part about this was Doug Peterson's plan pretty much dictated what the Cowboys did, and that's the frustrating part. On the defensive side of the ball was the genius part. Basically, and what we've seen this a couple times with the Cowboys, what they did just by alignment, they took Zeke out of the game. They said, we're going to load up the box, we're going to make Dak throw the football, and then they'll check out of it.
Wow.
Or they'll throw the football. And with Dak, with his ailing shoulder, we even saw in the warm-ups that we just showed, he threw a ball and then he'd kind of move his shoulder. And he wasn't feeling right. And I've had the AC joint. I know that you don't have that natural feel. You know where you want to throw the football. Your mind tells you to throw it in a certain location, and the ball doesn't make it there. So I'll show you, there's two plays that kind of stand out. There was one that was late in the game that was a little bit high. And this is it right here. What you're trying to do is you're trying to throw a deep in route to the top part of the screen. You got a three deep coverage. They actually do a nice job here disguising the coverage. It ends up playing like a cover too because you run the flat defender out there so the receiver has to wrap in there. There's a little hole to throw it in there. Now Dak has thrown this ball 100 times. He lets it go. He knows right where he wants to throw it and it gets away from him. It airmails and Amari's even kind of surprised where the ball goes. He only puts one hand up for it. And I guarantee Dak is like, I don't know. I don't know how I missed it. Usually I hit that. Same thing early in the game. Had a crossing route here. This ended up being a field goal for them. They could have probably had a first down with the throw. You watch, we're going to run a nice little crossing route, and it's just the throw is just a little bit off. You get a nice rub route. You have plenty of room for Gallup. He can catch this. Everyone's in man coverage. He might
run
the sideline for maybe a score. I mean, look, there's no one there, and he ends up throwing it behind him, and he misses it, and he probably had half a dozen, eight of those throws where I guarantee he doesn't feel like he'd miss that. And then for me on the offensive side, when you know your quarterback's struggling with that, you see that probably in practice, the inaccuracy. You have to find a way to get Zeke more than 13 carries. I know they're loading the box up, but we see teams all around the league designing plays to get them to run the football even with loaded boxes.
Yeah.
Zeke's faced that his entire career. His entire career's had guys up there. So you just can't get away from it and abandon it, especially when your quarterback's dealing with a shoulder injury.
All right, circle back to Philadelphia right now because you predicted the Eagles a couple few weeks ago.
Yes.
Philadelphia still hasn't closed the deal yet. They are at New York to take on the Giants. Giants look good on offense yesterday. Do you think Philadelphia closes the deal?
I think they close the deal, but I don't think it's going to be as easy as we expected. I think that with Daniel Jones coming back in, saw Eli play a couple weeks, like, hey, I can still do this. Then Saquon playing the way he did.
Yeah.
I mean, it's going to be a tough out, but I mean, the division's right there.
Yeah.
You got to go get it.
Peterson and company have been closers in recent years when it comes to clinching the playoff spot. Meanwhile, if Philadelphia gets tripped up, then the Cowboys have to beat Washington, and the Skins will not have their starting quarterback. Dwayne Haskins is done for the year. The rookie quarterback sprained his ankle yesterday. His season ends with 7 touchdowns and 7 interceptions. Case Keenum will start for Washington. Lindsay?
Tonight's game in Minnesota, huge for the NFC. Packers and Vikings both in the playoffs already, but the NFC North has yet to be decided. If the Packers win this one, the title is theirs. If the Vikings win, then it will all come down to next week's games. Kurt Warner has the call for radio on Westwood One, so he is at the game. Keeping an eye on the running backs down there on the field. You got any idea who's going tonight for the Vikings?
I actually do, Lindsay. There's no Dalvin Cook, as we knew, but Alexander Mattison is not going as well. So Mike Boone will be the lead back tonight. And I'm hearing some great things about him. They say he's got a skill set similar to Dalvin Cook. Now, probably not that explosive, but looking forward to seeing him play tonight.
What's that mean for Kirk Cousins? Feels like a really big game for him.
I think it's a huge game, and you mentioned some of the stakes, you know, when we're talking about the standings, but we all know this is bigger than that, that Kirk Cousins needs to show that he can play in this moment with another good team on the other side. He needs to prove it to himself that he can play on this stage because he's going to have to play here in just a couple weeks. But, you know, you have to believe they want to run the football. That's really where they've been good. Run the football, play action, roll Kirk Cousins out, but the good thing is he's got all his weapons. Adam Thielen, Stephon Diggs, the two tight ends, everybody's available to him. So you feel like this is one that the Vikings should get. But I'm still a little hesitant knowing number 12 on the other sideline and what he does in big moments like this.
Right. And if the Packers win, not only do they win the division, they will be in the mix for the one seed, rooting against the Niners next week when they play the Seahawks in prime time. Who are you leaning toward in that game?
Well, I tell you what, I mean, I said a couple weeks ago, I believe that when the 49ers are healthy, they're the most balanced team in the NFC. And I know the last couple weeks it hasn't been as pretty, but what I love is that in the biggest moments, they've come up extremely big. Jimmy Garoppolo has come up extremely big. We saw it against the Saints a couple weeks ago. We saw it against the Rams this past week. And then you got to look at the injuries in Seattle. I'm very fascinated to see how this affects what they do. No Chris Carson. That team is really built on the power run game. So I'm leaning towards the 49ers. Still, I believe they're going to come out of this thing and be the number one seed.
Thank you, Kurt. I'll be listening to you tonight on my drive home from work on Westwood One. In the meantime, I'm going to turn here to Willie McGinnis.
Yes.
Who also likes the Niners in that game next week, but saw a few things on Saturday that sparked some concern for their playoff run. What was it?
Well, when you're going into a playoff run, the great teams, they don't pat themselves on the back of the things they're doing really well. They look for the things they need to improve on. And when you look at that 49ers defense, it's the out-of-the-pocket plays. It's the misdirection plays. When you have an aggressive front, offensive coordinators find ways to do it. And when you watch what the Rams did in the first half, like a few other teams this week, they used it. They got Goff out of the pocket. They're going to run a bootleg to the left. When he gets out of the pocket, look at what this does for the second defenders. It pulls them out of the throwing lane. This opens up the one-on-one for Cooks in the back of the end zone. There's no contain on the outside. Makes it a pretty good throw for Cooks for a touchdown. Here it goes again. You're going to see it. It's going to be boot left again. They're going at Bosa this time. He's your right defensive end. Look at everybody go across. You got Reynolds running the slide. You got Higbee running the drag. They find open space for Reynolds, gives him the ball in space, and make another positive play. Okay, now we're going to get everybody up on the quarterback right now. We're going to get this sack. No, you're not. It's a screen. So now you got man on man. You got blockers. You got a convoy in front of the running back. You get him the ball. He makes a huge chunk. So when you're going against aggressive defenses like that and players like that, you got to be able to understand what they're trying to do to you or what they will do to you. The Cardinals, the Baltimore Ravens, the Rams, and the Seahawks all had quarterbacks and all implemented those type of plays that gave the 49ers problems.
And you know Pete Carroll saw exactly what you saw on tape there this past weekend. Every little thing counts right now, and yep. The Niners are not the only top seed that Willie has some concerns about. Still ahead, the thing that he saw that he did not like in the Ravens game. Scott?
Lindsay, got a few more headlines to pass along right now. James Conner had an MRI today on his injured quad. It's not known yet if he's going to be able to go in the regular season finale for the Steelers. They are at Baltimore to take on the Ravens. Conner has only played in 6 full games this season, dealing with various injuries. We do know that the Steelers will not have quarterback Mason Rudolph for Week 17. Steelers quarterback injured his shoulder yesterday against the Jets. Rudolph came in for the benched Devlin Hodges, so now Hodges goes back into the starting lineup by default. Some other news from Week 16, Cardinals quarterback Kyler Murray has a minor hamstring pull, they're calling it. Coach Cliff Kingsbury said that Murray will play on Sunday if he is healthy. And Panthers interviewed former Packers head coach Mike McCarthy for their open spot. Carolina fired longtime head coach Ron Rivera 3 weeks ago. Raiders coach John Gruden says there is a chance that Josh Jacobs could play Sunday at Denver. A shoulder injury kept Jacobs off the field yesterday.